I guess this time last week, the prevailing opinion was, sure, Bryce Young has been disappointing in Carolina, but who wouldn't be given his personnel? I subscribe to that. I think most people did. Then Andy Dalton goes out and wins a game this weekend. Does that change the dynamics or the conversation at all, what we just watched Andy Dalton do?
Not necessarily, and maybe not quite yet. Here's another thing that the average fan needs to understand about professional sports. Oftentimes you see it when managers or coaches are fired. When a high-profile move like this is made, sometimes subconsciously, if not consciously, it improves the play of other people on the team because they don't want to seem as though they were the issue after all, right? So I'm not saying that Andy Dalton didn't play a great game and that can't be the answer long term, but just because it was one win, I would not say, oh, see, it was Bryce Young the whole time. What happens to Andy the next game or the next three or four games? It could be all these other guys around him all of a sudden is like, yo, man, we got a new quarterback. We got to go. If not, they're going to think it's us. We're the real problem. Give it time to play out, and you're going to find out who this team really is. Was the play calling different because Andy Dalton was back there as opposed to Bryce Young? You don't know the answer to that until you see it over a long period of time. But for the organization itself, clearly they needed that because they just needed a win, but you still don't know if it's the answer.
We're in this weird time in the NFL as it pertains to quarterbacks where you look around and there's C.J. Stroud, who's been awesome just about from the jump. But for every C.J. Stroud, there's like three of these young guys who are really struggling. And then you look around the league and there's a Baker Mayfield, who was once a young, struggling quarterback, got a new home, now is doing okay. Sam Darnold was a young, struggling quarterback, got to give up on him. Now he seems to be doing okay. Is there a lesson in here somewhere for NFL franchises about how to handle these situations? Again, whatever example you're looking for, it's there. C.J. Stroud, Bryce Young, whatever you want. But it does. I just find it interesting that young quarterbacks are struggling, franchises are giving up on them, and then sometimes, more often than, you know, maybe you would assume, these once struggling quarterbacks are finding new homes and flourishing while a new batch of young quarterbacks struggle.
Yes, the lesson is there, but that don't mean teams are going to pay attention to it. I mean, C.J. Stroud is the rare exception
right.
to the norm. I mean, Tom Brady even talked about this over the summer during an interview, that they're putting these young quarterbacks in a position too early with expectations that ultimately lead to some type of failure. And there's way more examples of that than there are of C.J. Stroud. Tom Brady didn't start right off the bat. Patrick Mahomes didn't start right off the bat. Now, Troy Aikman did, Peyton Manning did, Eli Manning did, and they all struggled early and eventually became Super Bowl champions and Hall of Famers. But again, that's not the norm, right? These guys, especially considering sometimes now, Gary, in today's college football, how little time they are, a starter on their respective programs and how much time they have to develop. You need them to go to the NFL, watch, and then learn, right? That is the blueprint that's been more successful than any other by far. But because of the money that these guys are paid, owners and GMs feels like we've got to get a return on this investment as soon as possible, throw his ass out there. And what you end up doing sometimes, if your culture and your roster and your offensive line specifically are not built to support a young, developing quarterback, you end up just repeating the cycle over and over again. You draft a guy high, you get rid of him. You draft another guy high, you get rid of him. How long does it take before, you know what, we have to stick to a plan of development here, pick the right guy, and see if he can actually flourish?
I'm with you. And as I was thinking about this over the weekend, I brought Major League Baseball into it. And I don't know who's right and who's wrong. But what I do know is in Major League Baseball, they never operate under the assumption that you can go from college to the big leagues. Like, you cannot be more accomplished and heralded than Paul Skeens was coming out of LSU. Pitcher of the year, player of the year, won the College World Series, number one pick. And even they do not say, we think you should be competing in the College World Series one day, and then your next action should be, you know, in Pittsburgh against Atlanta. There's a way we're going to do this. You might be so awesome you get there quicker than most, and he did, but there is no scenario where we're taking you straight from here to straight from here. Should NFL quarterbacks, maybe NFL franchises, rather look at quarterbacks the same way and say, it doesn't matter if we think you can do it. History tells us you probably can't. We're going to do this another way.
Absolutely, because none of these guys, none of these teams that put out rookie quarterbacks to start are contenders for the Super Bowl anyway.
Right.
So what is time to you? Nothing. You have it to build something to try to get to the Super Bowl. But if you do it too early, you can wreck that entire plan. So that, to me, is what is so baffling sometimes, Gary. The blueprint, history, everything tells you what to do, but so many teams, out of fear, a fan, you know, backlash, or just trying to get some return on all that money you pay for these top draft picks now, they're like, no, we got to put them out there right now and see what happens.